Hey, I'm Matoli, and today I'm going to be teaching you about Booker T.
Can you dig it, sucker?
Where's that music coming from? I'm not talking about that Booker T. I'm talking about Booker T. Washington, the founder of Tuskegee Institute, now Tuskegee University. He focused on building up the economy for blacks, and he focused on making the laws better for them. Well, since we already know that Booker T. Washington founded Tuskegee Institute, let's see what's going on over there now.
Oh. Yeah. Finally famous in this. Yeah. That's over everything.
Wow. That was exciting. Well, I wonder if that's what Booker T. Washington intended for it. Well, times have changed, but that's pretty accurate. Whoa, where did you come from? From the past. Duh, dummy. You didn't think I was going to sit in my grave while you sat up here and attempted to tell my story? Well, no. Yes. Maybe. I don't know. I just didn't expect you to just appear. Well, now that I'm here, let's get on with it, why don't we? Okay, then. So, why did you think something like Tuskegee Institute was necessary for black people? How did you think it would help them? Well, I believe that there is as much dignity in tilling the field as there is in writing a poem. For example, during the Jim Crow era, blacks were faced with segregation and all-around unfair conditions. As a result of these conditions, black people were barely surviving, being broken down mentally and financially suffocated. With Tuskegee, I wanted to provide black people with an institution to help build their self-help and entrepreneurship skills with individualism, because at the bottom of education, at the bottom of politics, even at the bottom of religion, there must be, for all race, economic independence. And that was my hopes to establish for our race when I founded Tuskegee Institute. Well, that was pretty noble. Let's see if Tuskegee truly did help the students that attend.
Yeah, I believe Tuskegee University's impact on education extends well beyond HBCUs, with figures such as Booker T. Washington, George Washington Carver, Robert R. Taylor, Chappie James. Even now, to this day, of our 3,100 students, 2,100 of them are in STEM or STEM-related fields. And of course, being a predominantly historically black college, this is very significant. But they go on to successful careers, as our recent ranking as being number 6 in the state of Alabama with salaries for our graduates.
Looks like Tuskegee did and still is helping the black people succeed. Well, now I know what your intentions were for Tuskegee, but how did you help blacks economically? How did you help them build up their existence in the world? We needed whites to respect us as citizens and contributors to our existence as members of society. We as blacks needed to learn how to stand independently. Instead of focusing on the discrimination, we needed to focus on building our economic independence. And that's what Tuskegee did. It provided an education that built on our existing skills, such as industrial arts, farming, our abilities to be less wasteful with our money and resources, building our enterprises, and our willingness to be patient as we wait for our acceptance of our white counterparts.
You're just as big a dummy as you were a century ago.
Whoa, where are you guys coming from?
Hey, young fella. You look like a pretty intelligent Negro. How has waiting helped us thus far?
Well, I think it's been working out for us just fine. During the Jim Crow era, a Negro had an estimated 15,000 grocery and dry goods stores, 300 drug stores, and 63 banks. Negroes are paying taxes between 600 to 700 million on property of various kinds in the United States. Unless we had a reasonably fair chance in the South, we couldn't have gained or held this large amount of property and would not have been able to be a factor in the economy of this country to the extent that we had. The Negro has had much greater opportunities in the southern states where they were slaves versus the northern, because in the South, labor seeks us. We have business opportunities in the South that we don't have anywhere else. And in all my experience, I have never seen a Negro man or woman seeking labor in southern states who did not find it. Though the social treatment of the Negro draws thin lines, we have much better business and job opportunities in the South than we do in the North.
Well, if that's the case, how do you explain the great
migration of the 1960s and how union workers were treated after the Great Depression.
I knew you had some smarts in there, young man. Just like I've been saying all these years, we must be saved, like all other races, by our exceptional men. By developing the best of our race, we can build a community, which I refer to as a talented 10, which can guide our masses to success.
That's insane. I don't know how they consider you a scholar. You know what? Just shut up and get out.
Know what you're talking about? You don't know. You're just a big idiot, just like you were a century ago.
Get out of my face.
You don't know.
Get out of my face.
Shut up! Gosh! I thought my family was bad, but you guys ate the cake. Now, like I was saying before I was so rudely interrupted, you guys both have great stances. I think it should be more of a combination between the two. Like WB Du Bois was saying, we need leaders in politics, businesses of all kinds, and social activists, like he was describing with the Talented 10th. But on the other hand, we need to build our economic independence as a race. We need to support each other, build our black businesses, and take pride in our culture and heritage, which may mean we have to separate ourselves as people to build and find ourselves so we can gain respect from others, just like Booker T. Washington was saying.
You could be on to something, young man.
I appreciate that, but what I really appreciate is the knowledge you share with us. As we have long moved past the Jim Crow era, we still have some of the same issues in society today. They are just not as obvious as they were in the past. And it's a great thing when we can pull knowledge from the minds of the past. Glad you mentioned that, young man, because history often repeats itself. And you have to know where you come from to know where you're going.
Telegram, telegram for W.E.B. Du Bois.
Thank you, my good man. Well, my good man, that's my cue. It's time for me to go make history. Where the heck do you guys keep coming from? But anyway, we're quickly running out of time. And with all the changes happening in society and with our new president, what advice do you have for the people of America?
I stand where I've always stood, and I say as I've always said before, and I wish that you all take this into context of your own current conditions. In all things that are purely social, we can be as separate as the fingers, yet one as the hand, and all things essential to mutually progress. There is no defense or security for any of us except in the highest intelligence and development of all. If anywhere, there are efforts tending to reduce the fullest growth of the Negro. Let these efforts be turned into stimulating, encouraging, and making him the most useful and intelligent citizen. Effort or means so invested will pay 1,000% interest. These efforts will be twice blessed, blessing him that gives and him that takes. There is no escape through law of man or God from the inevitable. The laws of changeless justice bind the oppressor with the oppressed. Enclosed as sin and suffering, joined we march to fate abreast.
Well, there you have it, straight from Booker T. Washington himself. Sure, this wasn't the most traditional lesson, but I hope you learned something, and I hope you all take a stand for progression for all.
Booker T. Washington. Z, three, line two, take five.
Wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed. No more back thinking, time for thinking.